Well, I'll tell you what. We left the last episode with me drinking a successful anchor beer after taking the boat out, after finishing all that travel, then taking the boat out. And I was feeling pretty good a few days ago. And really, yesterday I finished that project inside the cabin, and I think that looks pretty good. We're just waiting on the cushion itself, which is being made out in California, and it's obviously the worst company I ever should have chosen, but I did, and they have my money, and I'm waiting on them to make the cushion. But that issue aside, the issue today is the engine. So all this dreams of planning a voyage and all that crap kind of have stalled. Because right now I'm back to, you know, basic vital statistics. And the problem is this. I'm looking down at the engine, okay? So this is our engine. I'm going on the starboard side. And I'm going to follow that red cable down. And if you look at the front end of the starter, you can see it's actually not attached anymore. I really don't know if you can see that. I can't see it. There's no way I can stick my head down in there to get a good look. So what I'm gonna do is just by going by feel, get some gloves on, and then see if I can bolt it back in, frankly. But that's without the ability to see what you're doing. So, excuse me, this engine and this engine compartment, you see all the leg room I have back here. This is more than most people have. So my access to the engine is pretty good, but if it's something that's needed on the sides of the engines, this is not a good engine layout. The compartment layout is not too good. So I'm gonna give another go here and see what I can get bolted up before we quit for the day, and mostly just do some thinking. And frankly, it's got me, I have to admit that it's got me thinking, you know, oh my God, what if I have to repower the engine? Because this is also the same engine that's got a fuel leak that has been fixed with JB Weld, which is right in here also. You can see the shiny stuff on top of the fuel injector pump. I'll take a picture of this and put an arrow to show you. That repair seems to have held up just fine, actually. And the reason I didn't want to take off the fuel injector pump and send it off for rebuild is because I'd have to remove this manifold and the water hoses underneath it just to gain physical access. And I really wasn't too hip on doing that. And I really didn't have a good place to send the fuel injector pump anyway. There's supposedly a place up in Fort Lauderdale. You know, but outside my strength area. So I guess I've got to make this a strength area, really. That's the bottom line. I've been kind of getting by for 2.5 years on this boat, just changing oil and checking the oil and keeping the water full and checking the belts, and I change the alternator and I change the filters, of course, and all that hoo-ha, and I keep the fuel clean, and that's kind of got me along this far. But now I've actually got to do engine work. And shit, I haven't done that since I was 16 years old. So kind of disappointed, kind of subdued, you know, because I know I'm entering into a zone where I'm not really comfortable as far as my skill level, so I don't want to fuck it up even worse. But with the starter about to physically fall off the engine, I mean, what else could I do that's worse? So I'll strap on some gloves and see what happens and give it a go here. Okay, oh my God, that's a heavy son of a bitch. Okay, so looking at this, a couple of thoughts come to mind. I think I can just, if I can lift up the starter motor back into position, I think I can probably get both bolts in. One of the bolts I cannot reach by fingers, but I can probably get a wrench on it with an extension. But it's very difficult to hold the starter into position and bolt the bolts and get them started. So I think I'm going to use either a zip tie or some kind of rope to hold the starter into position and then re-bolt it in there and then do a test run to see if the engine runs still and if it'll crank. That's step one. But while I was looking at that, I'm realizing if I want to get the proper torque on these bolts, or if I want to remove the bolts and put a lock washer in there or put some Loctite on it, I'm going to need to remove these interferences down here. So the interferences include the exhaust manifold itself, and below that these two blue pipes, one here and one there, they contain coolant. And to be honest, I don't remember. One of the bottom one I know is saltwater coolant because it's coming right out of the pump. And the top one, I think, is the saltwater coming back, which for reasons I don't fully understand, goes in to cool, I suppose, the exhaust manifold, or that's the water, I suppose, that goes into the wet exhaust. Honestly, I really don't know how that works. But either way, all three interferences have to go if I want to do a proper job of rebuilding this dam. Okay, yeah, so all three of those interferences are going to have to be removed, and it's going to spew salt water all over the place. But I need to remove them all if I want to get a proper job of permanently reinstalling the starter motor. If I want to go after the starter properly, then I'm going to have to remove these interferences. But if I remove the interferences for that, then I've also removed the interferences for my fuel injector pump. And so I suppose if I head down that rabbit hole and decide to go after the starter motor properly, that's also a decision to go after removal of the fuel injector pump, sending it off for a shop for a rebuild, which it needs anyway, because that's the one that's is currently fixed with epoxy, JB Weld. So I just got to think that through a little bit before I make a decision. The immediate decision is to temporarily rig up, you know, to rig into place the starter motor. It's too heavy for me to hold by hand and get the bolt started. You can only manipulate so much with two hands and something you really can't even see. So get the starter motor back in position, try to get the bolts back in, test run the engine, see if it'll crank, and then the immediate crisis is over. And then we got to think about, do I want to go after it, you know, buy a new starter, get some Loctite on the bolts, you know, clean them and get Loctite on them, but I can't even touch one of them. You know, that's the thing. How are you supposed to do that if you can't even touch it? So anyway, so let me go after this. I'll let you know the results. Okay, so I have it bolted up. That took a bit of doing, but I used a rope in my patented clove hitch to hoist the starter into position, and I got the bolts back in the holes, and I got them, I'll call it wrench tight as I can get them. It's very difficult to get any ass on them, you know, you can't, and to get a torque wrench in there is pretty much, and to get a torque wrench in there is borderline out of the question. So, but now we just want to do a quick test start and see what happens here. So hold the camera with my knee. So we got the starter motor bolted back in, and it is perfectly functional, and the engine does work. So I could stop right there and live with the starter that is kind of had the mysterious case of backing its mounting bolts out, which I'd never seen before. And also live with the fuel injector pump that is held together by epoxy. Or I can go after the job properly, since I have about 5 or 6 weeks before the weather turns and starts getting nice for cruising again. We might as well just get this job done. And I thought about it, and it's not going to be all that bad, I don't think, because the two interferences that are really in the way are these two pipes. And I call them pipes, but they're really not pipes in a traditional sense. They're just metal tubes that connect a hose on one end, and there's a hose on the other end. So really, they're just extremely rigid pipes, or hoses. And this is the seawater coming into the engine. That's the raw water pump. We'll shut the valve.
disconnect the hose and probably elevate this end of the hose up high so that even if the seacock leaks, water cannot enter the boat. We'll drain this out, remove this fitting, that one. On the other end, do the same thing. On the other end, for the comeback line, remove the both ends and just dump all the water to bilge and do the cleanup. Then we're going to relocate physically the heat exchanger to that bulkhead over there. And it's never going to be mounted on the engine again, which means these will never be back in this location. And these pipes will be gone to trash. We'll get a hose, I think it's a 1-inch ID, and we'll get enough hose to just make the run directly over there for both ends of the hose. And that'll be that. And then that, just that simple act, ought to provide sufficient clearance and access that, this is the hard part, I'm trying to get my camera in here. Please stand by. Now you're upside down. And if we do that, that should give us access to the starter motor, which is the ugly brown round thing. You can see the lube oil lines are going there, and that's where the lube oil pressure sender ought to be if I get a new sender unit. And further up above this is the fuel injector pump. See, that's where the fuel injector pump is, behind these blue pipes. So if I relocate these lines, then that really ought to kind of enable me to work the fuel injector pump and rework the starter mounting bolts. And probably, I think it's very possible, I'm not going to have to remove this exhaust manifold at all. That's what I think, because if I don't have to remove this or that, I'll be a happier, much happier camper. Although when I first bought the boat, the guys did have it off, because the thermostat is under this, which I think is stupid, but that's what they do. The top of the block is here, and and that's where the thermostat is, so you have to remove this thing, reservoir, tank, whatever you want to call it. Now that has to come off in order to get at the thermostat. And I know when I first bought the boat, I paid diesel guys to do exactly that. So they have been off before, so I'm sure I can get those bolts off and remove it if we need to. And then it's a matter of just reworking the freshwater lines to go to the new location where the heat exchange is going to be. And those are just 5/8 inch line, and I think I have some of that already in stock. So, and that's as far as we're planning to take the job. So I'm not really sure if that makes sense. Before I start anything, maybe I need to call the fuel injector people up in Lauderdale and make sure they have, you know, if everybody's on vacation, it'll take 16 weeks to get the pump back. Well, then I need to change my plan. Maybe buy a new injector pump, whatever you got to do. Better to have them rebuild the existing pump. So I'm going to add that as a step one, really, is call them tomorrow and just say, hey, are you available? Can you do it? How do I get it to you? The basic logistics, and then, because that's really going to be what drives the schedule of the project, is how quickly I can get the pump to them and get it back from them. And everything else I could probably do locally. And I'll tell you one other thing. I'm also considering relocating the oil cooler. Now, this boat has an oil cooler which is cooled by the freshwater side of the system. So I'm going to have to retube the freshwater going to the oil cooler anyway. And if that's the case, maybe I should go ahead and relocate it so it's no longer on the block and put it on the opposite bulkhead. And that would give me so much easier access to the engine-mounted fuel pump and the fuel filter, which are both over there, and they are directly above the oil cooler, so you can't get the bowl off the bottom of the injector because there's an oil cooler there. So relocating the oil cooler and the heat exchanger off of the engine block is really the project now. And getting the starter reworked is kind of just a benefit anymore. Once you get the access, working the starter and working the injector pump ought to be much, much, much easier. So that's kind of where my head's at. I'm going to close out this video now, guys, and get this thing issued. And then we'll try to get to work, and we're going to try to make the best use we can of the next 4 or 5 weeks of engine work. And, of course, I'll take pictures along the way. So with that, we're doing fine here on the boat. The weather is actually pretty nice today. It's a neutral day. A big weather front coming through Tuesday night. The whole USA is pretty much going to feel this one, but it rips through us on Tuesday night into Wednesday. We're expecting to get you know, the really, the I won't call it violent, but the wind and the rain, and then we'll probably have a couple days of cold northerly wind, so that's going to suck, but you don't sweat too much, so no complaints with that at all, and it's all good, guys. So, that, cheers, man. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.
Texas Trails on the way.
There's no need to cry.
Good luck with your trip.
See you again one day.
Stay in touch, we'll see you again.
I'll wave bye-bye. The sailing ship reminds me.